You're listening to The Jake Asmon Show on the Sports Map Radio Network.
Presented by Rocket Mortgage.
Live from the O'Reilly Auto Parts Studios, here's Jake Asmon.
We waste no time with our next guest. You can watch him tonight on the coverage of the Canadiens at the Tampa Bay Lightning. Game 2 from Tampa, 8 p.m. Eastern, is Puck Drop on NBC Sports Network. He's one of the best hosts in the business. He is Liam McHugh, and he joins us right now on the Progressive Guest Line. Liam, as always, appreciate the time. How you doing, my friend?
I'm doing well. What's going on, buddy?
Let's start with this. How is the playoff beard coming along?
It is weak and patched, I'd say, like very similar to the Canadiens' effort in game one, especially in the third period. It's an extremely poor Irish version of a playoff beard. If growing a neck beard was the thing to do, I could handle that, but apparently that's extremely unattractive. My wife says it can't happen. So, but I've taken it this far. So, you know, I'm going to take it home.
Do you regret taking it this far, or at this point you're like, you know what, I've made it this far, you know, it is what it is, I just got to deal with it?
No, you know what, I would say this. I never regret not shaving. If I could not shave forever, I mean, I don't care what I look like. I mean, you know, other people may not like it, so but it doesn't matter to me, and we have fantastic makeup people who try to cover up for whatever hideous things I put on my face. So no regrets at all. Keeping it going.
Well, in fairness to you, you're working with Patrick Sharp, who might be the most handsome person on the planet. So it's tough to be compared to him, you know, when you're standing there on set with him. Is that fair?
Well, I think we're at that point where it's like, why bother? Right? Why bother? I mean, I used to get to stand next to Milbury and Jonesy, and it was fantastic because, you know, I was 20 years younger than one of them and 15 years younger than the other. The two guys took a beating in hockey. The job was great. It was easy. Then Patrick Sharp came on, and it was like, my grooming routine, the makeup routine, everything was taking like 3 hours longer just so I could attempt to keep up. That's done. I'm middle-aged. I got three kids. Patrick Sharp is gorgeous. That's the way it is. You can stare at him and just listen to my voice.
Liam McHugh with us here talking all things NHL Stanley Cup Finals. So you mentioned game one. Of course, the Canadiens come out. They're red hot coming into the series. But now they're playing a Lightning team that might be, you know, the best team in the league, especially with, you know, Kucherov. You know, after not playing all season, then he comes back for the playoffs and he's been incredible, as, you know, every Tampa fan has seen up close. What did you make of game one, though, and what adjustments do you expect maybe both teams to make entering tonight?
I thought it was...
Let's see, did we lose Liam there? I think he cut out. Ron, see if we could get Liam back up on the line. Is he here? Liam, do you still hear us? Let's see. So Liam's phone dropped. Ron will call him back, and we'll work on getting him up. I mean, look, Liam alluded to it there before his phone unfortunately cut off. I mean, game one was a buzzsaw for the Canadiens to be walking into, but we've seen this. And in hockey, you flip the switch real quick. All it takes tonight would be the Canadiens coming out and, you know, getting the first goal and setting the tone. See, Tampa's a dangerous team because when – you know, the Canadiens are going to try and play it similar to how the Islanders are going to play it. Like, when you're facing, you know, a team with an offense that good, and you let them score the first goal, and you let them put pressure on you, then, you know, your system kind of goes out the window, and you're trying to come from behind, and it's very, very dangerous. And we saw that, obviously, in game one. So scoring first tonight, I imagine, would be huge for Montreal. I believe we do have Liam back with us. His line cut out. Liam, apologies on our end for that, and I hope you can hear us okay.
I've got you, buddy. I've got you. I have no idea where I cut off. Just know that I kept talking and I made some brilliant points.
Well, how about this? I asked you what adjustments you expect both teams to make, you know, particularly Montreal. Of course, they lose 5-1 in game one. So let's continue that part of the conversation. What adjustments do you see both teams making later?
Well, I think the focus on Nikita Kucherov is real. And we saw it with Shea Weber. He, you know, gets a $5,000 fine for slashing on Nikita Kucherov. I don't think they're going to shy away from the rough stuff. I think they're going to try and not take it over the edge because you can't put Tampa Bay on the power play because they will absolutely destroy you. But they're going to hit, and they're going to continue to hit. That's not going away. I mean, I don't think Tampa Bay minds it. They've proven that they can win in different ways. But Montreal knows that, you know, man-to-man, they are not as talented as this team. So they want to ugly this game up. They want to slow it down. They want to play a defensive-minded game. And then every once in a while, it's almost like we've been watching the Euros of soccer. They want to counterattack. all of a sudden sneak a guy behind you when you're feeling good offensively, get a breakaway and try to score that way. They need low scoring games. They're not going to win a track meet. For Tampa Bay, I think it's just keep your composure. I mean, if you're going to get slashed, you're going to get hit. Don't retaliate. Just hit as hard as you can within the lines. Play right on the edge. Don't take penalties. Because I think at this point, Tampa Bay has proven it. They're the deepest team. They are the most talented team. And right now, Montreal's got a lot of work to do. This almost looks like, Jake, what you would have expected if these two teams played in the first round of the playoffs, given the regular seasons that both teams had. You know, you can sort of throw out the playoffs and what led up to this point for game one, because I think it really came down to this is a more talented team, a deeper team, and now Montreal's got some work to do.
Does it still boggle your mind that the Canadiens are even in this spot? I mean, they had less points in the regular season than a team like the Rangers who missed the playoffs. Like, yeah. It's surreal to me that, you know, they have even made it this far.
Oh, 100%. I mean, I think they benefit from playing in what was the weakest division in hockey, no doubt. But to your point, they were the last team in from the weakest division. They were 18 points out of first place in the worst division. But they played the Leafs first round. They get the benefit of a team that's very talented but has no idea how to win playoff series. So they beat them. They play Winnipeg, Mark Scheifele. He gets suspended for, you know, the rest of that series in the first game of it. So they lose their best player. They beat them, and then somehow they get past Vegas. But I think you get confidence along the way. They have a nice mixture of some veteran players with Corey Perry and Eric Staal, and then some young talent like Cole Caulfield and Nick Suzuki. And they have a generational talent in goal in Carey Price. They're not as good as Tampa. I'm amazed that they're there. But I will tell you this much. The big story about Montreal, of course, is the fact that they haven't won the Stanley Cup since 1993. No Canadian team has won the Stanley Cup since 1993. But they've been playing this we're the underdog card the entire time, and that's the truth. There's no pressure on us. There's pressure now. You can't get to this point. You can't get this close, lose, and say we were just happy to be there. Now there's real pressure, and I think some of those young guys on the team that I mentioned, Suzuki and Caulfield, I think they felt that pressure in game one.
Liam McHugh with us here, NBC Sports NHL host. You can watch him tonight, of course, game two, Canadiens and Lightning on NBC Sportsnet. You know, you look at, you know, the Tampa Bay Lightning, and I'm sure their fans are tired of hearing about, oh, well, your team is cheating. Your team is over the cap. You know, I'm an Islander fan, but, you know, to me, the Lightning did what every other team would do, Liam. Like, I have no issue with the Lightning manipulating the cap. It's within the rules. Where do you fall on, you know, the backlash that the Lightning are facing because Kucherov, of course, doesn't play in the regular season, but because of the rules in the CBA, if he doesn't play and he comes back for the playoffs, but then his salary cap doesn't factor in to the overall cap for the season.
I am so tired of it. It is such a tired and ridiculous argument that fans who are jealous and annoyed make, and fans who, if their team did this and they were in this situation, would be saying the complete opposite.
Yep.
They'd be saying, hey, we played within the rules. We did what we had to do. I mean, it's a ridiculous argument. You can say manipulated it. They did what they could do to get to this point. Break any rule, get away with anything. They just, you know, played it perfectly. That being said, they also have a former MVP, Nikita Kucherov, not played for the entire season, and they were right near the top in terms of points in the NHL. How many other teams could say, hey, let's have our MVP not play for the entire season? We'll be fine. We'll still make the playoffs. How many, like, do you think the Oilers are making the playoffs if Connor McDavid sits out the entire time? Do you think the Leafs, well, maybe they will. Probably not. The Leafs probably don't make the playoffs if Austin Matthews sits out. The Pens don't make the playoffs if Sidney Crosby sits out the entire time. So to me, it's a lazy argument. It's a tired argument. I think what people in general, they're sick of seeing Tampa because they won it last year. Tampa's been a competitive team for a long time. They've been in the conference final or the Stanley Cup final. The only time they didn't in the last few years is the time they were swept in the first round, and that was the season they had one of the greatest regular seasons in NHL history. So I think people get a little jealous, and I think they're also sick of the success down in Tampa. It's a weird thing for American sports fans that Tampa is now title town. It's strange. We're all getting used to it. They have a Stanley Cup. They're going for a second, and they have the Super Bowl and Tom Brady, and the rest of us just have to deal with it.
It's unbelievable. And, you know, as far as just the NHL and the CBA, why is that a thing where you could go over the cap, you know, if you don't have a guy play in the regular season. Can that be worked out in the future? I mean, obviously,
it'll be brought up. It'll be brought up, definitely. It has to be, because I think they're going to look at this and they have to look a lot more closely. And I remember there were times during the season where they're like, hey, Nikita Kucherov's on the ice and skating with the team. So immediately some teams are like, well, if he's on the ice skating with the team, why isn't he playing? And therefore, why isn't he counting against the cap? So I think things are going to be looked at a lot more closely. It's a strange situation, but what it does is obviously it allows potentially for a little bit more movement during the trade deadline, because if you do have people on long-term injured reserve, it allows you to deal for guys. It certainly allowed the Tampa Bay Lightning to get Savard at the deadline. That helped them. And I would say for someone in my situation, I like it simply because I want as much movement at the deadline as possible. I want as many stories as possible, and I want things to be interesting. That being said, I think it's something that can be tweaked, but this is the NHL. Sometimes things that need to be tweaked take a very long time to be tweaked. I mean, you know, it moves at a snail's pace. But I think there'll be enough voices and enough GMs who are a little bit upset with this, or maybe a little bit upset with themselves that they didn't think of something similar. And there may be a little bit of an impetus to make some small changes.
Liam, is it bittersweet for you guys at NBC going through, you know, this cup run for the final time? I mean, what's it been like where, you know, all the talk is about, oh, TNT's getting the NHL rights and then ESPN's getting the rights. And it's like, well, hello, you know, NBC is still, you know, covering the playoffs here. You guys still have a job to do.
It's strange. It is. There's no doubt about it. I mean, we've been doing this for a long time. My first Stanley Cup final was 2011, Boston Bruins, Vancouver Canucks, and, you know, Keith Jones has been doing it even longer than I have at NBC. So, yeah, I mean, it's odd. It's a sad ending. I have a lot of good friends there. It's a strange thing every day to see how excited people are, obviously, about, you know, anytime something's new or different, everyone assumes it's going to be better. And who knows? Maybe it will be. But, you know, I think we did a pretty good job here. I think we helped expand the sport. I will tell you this. The shows in the last few weeks have been some of my most enjoyable ones, because there is a certain freedom to knowing that this is the last time you're doing something and you're not necessarily as worried about upsetting certain people along the way. And you can definitely speak your mind a little bit more openly. So in that respect, it's been a good thing. And it's been a great run. And I think, you know, as someone in this business, I mean, I've been 10 years here doing this, and 10 years doing one sport at one network is an eternity in this job. So, you know, I think it's probably healthy for the league that they move on and get a couple different partners and change it up a little bit. But yeah, for us, it's a strange time. It's a difficult time. But it's still a lot of fun. I'm glad we're getting to take it home here. Although I have to say, I wish we could be on the road for this. All I wanted during my 10 years was to do a Stanley Cup final up in Montreal, see that atmosphere. And certainly it's changed because there's only 3,500 people in the building. So doing it from the studio is not quite as fun, but you know, it's, we'll see it through, and then we'll see what happens next year.
Finally, Liam, I saw you were at a couple of the games at the Nassau Coliseum with your sons. I mean, how special was it for you to, you know, one, be there and see the Islanders play meaningful games once again at the Nassau Coliseum, but for your kids to get a chance to experience that?
Incredible. Incredible. I grew up on Long Island, as you know. When I was a kid, you know, the Islanders were the kings here. They won four straight. It was such a big deal. And it was my son's first time going to an Islander game at Nassau Coliseum. We saw game six. They took out the Bruins. No one was more nervous in that building than I was, because first off, it's a big crowd of people, which I was not used to being around. Not a lot of mask wearing in that area. But more than that, I'm not nervous about the Islanders winning. I'm basically just nervous about what are my children, my sweet, innocent 6 and 7 year old boys, going to see here at the Nassau Coliseum in game six against the Bruins. Safe to say they learned a lot of new phrases, a lot of new words, which they then proceeded to tell their mom all about the next morning when we had breakfast. But other than that, it was, you know, it was so special. That is one of the great venues to see a hockey game. It is unbelievably loud. The fans are so passionate. And even though they didn't make it to the final, I think their last few games at the Coliseum, the perfect way to go out at the Coliseum with those wins, you know, and really just the entire atmosphere and the entire scene there.
Your kids must have loved the Josh Bailey song, right?
liked the Josh Bailey song. They liked saying Tuca every time. Tuca-esque didn't make a save. That was a big fan. And then I had to inform them that, no, Boston does not, in fact, suck. It's a wonderful city. You'll get to visit it sometime, and you will enjoy it.
Liam, you're the best. Best of luck. The rest of the series here, we'll be watching. You've done a tremendous job. Playoff beard looks great, despite what anyone tells you on Twitter. And definitely got to get you on again soon. Appreciate your time, as always, man.
You got it. All right. Always fun talking to you.
Liam McHugh with the Sarah NBC Sports host. You can follow him on Twitter at @Liam_McHugh. Does a great job, obviously, hosting the NHL for NBC. And it's bittersweet, I'd imagine, for all those guys. I mean, everyone's talking about ESPN and TNT. And it's like, hello, we still have to do our jobs here, wrapping up the Stanley Cup for the 2021 year. We'll take a quick break and continue. This is the Jake Asman Show here on a Wednesday on Sports Map Radio.
Sports Map all night. Come on. Just